Good evening. Good evening.
All right, that's a lot better. My name is Professor Anthony Brown. I am a faculty associate here at Roosevelt House and the chair of the Department of Africana and Puerto Rican Latino Studies. It is in this capacity that I have the distinct pleasure of welcoming you here this evening and delivering a short introduction. But before I do that, I really want to thank the staff here at Roosevelt House, in particular, Faye Rosenfeld, Bill Goldstein, who I've seen running around, and Cindy Pierre Noel, who have all worked tirelessly to make sure that we have first-rate programming here at this institution. Tonight, as we know, we have a special guest, Professor Margo Jefferson, and she will be speaking in conversation with Karen Hunter about her memoir, Negroland, and this is all part of our fall program series here. Margo Jefferson is a Pulitzer Prize winning cultural critic. She's been a staff writer at the New York Times and Newsweek. Her reviews and essays have appeared in New York Magazine, Vogue, Harper's, and many, many other publications. Her other book, entitled On Michael Jackson, was published in 2006. As a sociologist who studies race, I wanted to briefly offer some contextualization about the book. Negroland is beautifully written and a very important contribution to the relative dearth, if you will, of serious writing about the Black upper class. Media and scholarly attention has almost exclusively focused its attention on the experiences of the Black poor and working classes at the expense of the Black upper class. And I might add, a class that has existed, we can document, at least since the mid-1800s. This early upper class largely made its wealth servicing the Black community as lawyers, doctors, entrepreneurs, during the period of slavery through Jim Crow in the South and in the North, persisting despite de facto segregation in cities like New York and elsewhere. This group of African Americans has had a history of organizations and activities that distinguish it from many other classes within the Black community, as well as the white upper class. Contrary to conventional understanding, the Black community has often and always has been differentiated, particularly around and along lines of class and social status. Historically, I see this book in conversation with a number of African American writers, many of whom are referenced in the book, certainly including W.E.B. Du Bois and his conceptualization of the talented 10th, E. Franklin Frazier's work, The Black Bourgeoisie, many of James Baldwin's writings, Mary Petillo's work, Black Picket Fences, Lawrence Otis Graham's book, Our Kind of People, and perhaps most recently, Colson Whitehead's Sag Harbor. They all engage the complex sensibilities around aspiration, ambition, achievement, anxiety, as well as notions of responsibility that impact this group. The Black 1%, if you will, has not existed without controversy within the Black community. Issues of classism, colorism, snobbery, and the internalization of dominant white notions of respectability and beauty have at times been contentious. For some, its members are a success story, a group that has, quote unquote, made it despite racism advancing their race and the cause of better race relations. They have been praised and admired, especially in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, as representing the best and brightest of the race, as well as a class that could most easily develop relations with whites. But they've also been critiqued, especially since the publication of Carter G. Woodson's 1930s book, The Miseducation of the Negro. The Black bourgeoisie was a favorite target of Malcolm X, and Richard Wright questioned their notions of appropriate Blackness. As Professor Jefferson mentions in the book, the Black consciousness movement of the 1960s challenged ideas regarding the conceptualization of appropriate Blackness and the inherent denigration of Black culture and aesthetics that often occurred. Many of these themes are masterfully addressed by Professor Jefferson in the book. With astonishing candor, gallows humor, and wit, She demystifies and dispels romanticized conceptions of Black upper-class life. Lastly, given the racial configurations we have witnessed since Ferguson, respectability politics, with its emphasis on appropriate middle-class behaviors, has reemerged as an issue in the Black community. I would argue Negroland provides us with ample reason for caution. Tonight's program will be an interview format. Our interviewer, Karen Hunter, is a professor in the Department of Film and Media Studies here at Hunter College. She's a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, radio host, and author of many, many books, as you can research. Professor Hunter will ask questions for roughly about 35 minutes, followed by a question and answer period. We do ask that you come directly to your questions during that particular period. I now turn the program over to Professor Karen Hunter.
Good evening, everyone. I want to thank you for writing the book. As I read it, I struggled as a Black woman reading some of these historical passages, reading some of your very poignant and honest depictions of your life growing up in this place called Negroland. And I think it sparked a conversation that I had with myself that I hopefully we will all have tonight. But I want to start with why Negroland. So you start off saying, I call it Negroland because I find Negro, a word of wonders, glorious and terrible, a word for runaway slave posters and civil rights proclamations, for social constructs and street corner flaunts, a tonal language word whose meaning shifts as setting and context shift, as history twists, lurches, advances, and stagnates, as capital letters appear to enhance its dignity, as other nomenclatures arise to challenge its primacy. I call it Negroland because Negro dominated our history for so long, because I lived with its meaning and intimations for so long, because they were essential to my first discoveries of what race meant, or as we now say, how race was constructed. This is so lyrical, by the way. It's like poetry. But I wanted to know, first of all, Negroland, a memoir by Margo Jefferson. Why did you write this book?
I say a little later on that I'm a chronicler, an elegist, a dissenter, all of the above. I was born in 1947. My mother died last year at 98. I wanted to really record a particular way of living as a person of color, as a person taking great pride in being this haute bourgeoisie, as my mother once very wisely said when I said, "Were we upper class?" Because someone had asked me this at school. She said, "Well, we are considered upper class Negroes. We are considered upper middle class Americans, and there are many white people who just want to consider us more Negroes." So, I wanted to capture all of those distinctions and negotiations and certainties at the same time that uncertainties were going on everywhere. Just always identity being confronted and confounded. I wanted to get the rituals of a world that still exists, but that not in the same way. And that's why I had to use that word. And land, by land I mean literally the geographical boundaries that we all know perfectly well in a city that have to do with class, ethnicity, race, but also that sense that we were bordered on one side by the larger world of Blacks, on the other side by white people, some of whom we knew, most of whom we didn't. Also, a land is a mythic space. Anyone who's had to leave their homeland, knows that it's in your heart and in your brain, and it shapes your unconscious as well as your conscious. So I wanted that sense too.
And as you're unpacking Negroland, I got a sense that you, in many ways, opened a window that very few people get to peek into. And I felt on some level you were telling stories that have been secret to a mainstream audience. As I look in this audience, many people have never been to Negroland, not the Negroland that you grew up in. And I'm like, why are you telling so many secrets in here about what's going on in our culture, in our community?
Well, I'm not by any means the first, but probably,
you
know, we may know
the
fiction, than, you know, the novel, short stories, plays a little better. I had to struggle with that. And then I thought, you know, because the pressure, and this is not just the way I grew up or when I grew up. When you belong to a group that is discriminated against, whose value is always being debated, you can be black, you can be all manner of things, you can be a woman, you know, some sense of protecting your reputation is always there. You know, oh, is that, was that done by, oh, no, please, that crime, no, because you're always contemplating and confronting how a stereotype might jump up and hit you and finish you off, or how you might embody a stereotype. So you're taught to be very careful about saying or doing anything that gives prejudice, as we used to say, or bigoted people, ammunition. And part of that is you don't tell family secrets that aren't flattering. Family in the sense of your people as well as your immediate family. But I thought that could be, you know, as a writer, an interesting tension for a memoir, because I was also interested in what a memoir, you know, can do that's full of in conflict almost with, oh, I'm telling my story. You know, I almost called this, the subtitle was almost a cultural memoir, because it is the story of a culture and the story of an individual, a personality within that. You know, if it were a novel, I'd have been the lead character, but absolutely, whoa. And don't knock over glasses. That's in right. Public, Margo, yeah. Jefferson. But, you know, absolutely in this dramatized and reflected upon context.
Well, that was my struggle as I read it, you know, because you took us through a historical depiction of Negroland, and you talk about black slaves owning slaves, which, you know, we've seen it.
And yes, spoken. And there's that wonderful Edward P. Jones novel.
Right,
yeah.
The Known World, which yes. won a Pulitzer, you know, and I struggled with that book, to be honest with
yes,
you.
Yes, I know.
But so I'm going through this, and I'm going through Du Bois's Talented Tenth, and I'm going through, so take
And later through, his critique of
right,
that, yeah.
And his evolution out of, you know, this notion that there could be somehow this grand group of people who could oversee the rest of black folk to teach us how to be, you know. So take us through the work that you put into making sure that we had historical references and how you discovered them, because there were some things in here I'd never heard of before, and I read a lot.
I do. You know, I had a huge shelf of books. The most direct were several, several books of history on the so-called black elite. They had various titles. I had books on Chicago history. I went back to, I think it was an Ira Berlin book on, I think it was called Masters Without Slaves. It's about blacks in South Carolina, the privileged class, who many of whom were, not many of whom, but some of whom were slave owners. So, you know, I was ranging over general black history, sociology. There were certain texts I knew I had to take up. Of course, you have to take up Du Bois, you know, the double consciousness and the Talented Tenth. So there's certain sociological texts have to take up E. Franklin Frazer, you know, black sociology. I read etiquette books, manners books, you know, to remind myself of, you know, these rules and regulations. I read about housing, you know, or read at books on housing patterns in Chicago. You have to cast, you know, your eye in many, many, many directions. And, you know, it makes you anxious, because I'm you know, I'm thoughtful, I have a scholarly streak, but I am not, you know, a formal scholar. My training as a critic helped, you know, because I'm used to going in a lot of directions for something. But that chapter, the history chapter, took a long time because I wanted it to be dynamic.
And it was.
And but, you know, not drab, but not simplistic.
And I thought it was fascinating how you went from first person into third person. So in many ways, you were going in and out as a writer and taking us through this journey.
Yes. Sometimes I'm omniscient. Sometimes I'm a vulnerable character. That also interested me in terms of a memoir, the form of it. You know, how many personae can are populating the page? But also, it seemed honest to the double and sometimes triple identities that I was confronting. And all, again, I keep using the word negotiations. And there's that triptych also of class, race, and gender, you know, and you have to change your position and your tone and your literary strategies to do this.
Tell us the first time little Margot understood that there might be something different about her family dynamic or her family culture as it related to other blacks, when there was a juxtaposition from the Negroland that the Jeffersons lived in and perhaps the rest of black America.
Well, the two things that really stay in my mind, the neighborhood that we lived in for, you know, for a good part of my childhood, I was increasingly
in Chicago?
Yes, in Chicago. I was increasingly aware of what I wasn't calling, but of what was the half of the block that was very, quote, respectable, and the other half of the block that was starting to, as my parents saw it, slip down. You know, and I write in the book about being very interested in the girls at the downward side of the block and wanting to play double dutch with them, and then, you know, these little conflicts, and then after a little fight with them, overhearing my parents saying, I think we're going to have to move. You know, this neighborhood is changing, that kind of thing. Yeah. Also, this is not an unpleasant memory, but I registered it often when we all took trains in the 50s. How many of you remember you would take trains often? And I remember at the train station, the red caps, many of them their children were among my father's patients. So they would, hello, Dr. Jefferson. They were not ingratiating, but, you know, there was, yes, you know, my father was being gracious and they were being maybe a little deferential. So
you knew there was a chasm.
I knew there was, I didn't see it as a chasm at that moment because it was not unpleasant, but I knew there were distinctions.
And how did that make you feel? Because, you know,
it depends entirely on the tone. You know, my grandmother owned several buildings, and they were hard won, my mother's mother. And she would collect the rent herself, and I once went with her, and she was very peremptory with one of the tenants. You know, I don't have the rent this week. I'm really not interested in what you don't have. So and so. Oh my God. it was, and then I had to go home and say to my mother, this, I adored my grandmother. This was really.
You'd never seen that side of her.
She'd fussed at me, but that was quite different. You know, Margo Jefferson, come back here. She's my grandmother. This, and my mother acknowledged that to her credit. She said, yes, you know, I've seen that, and it's uncomfortable, it's unpleasant, but then we didn't go any further.
There's a lot of distinctions made, not just class, but complexion, hair texture, body shape, nose shape in this book that, you know, some of us reading it who aren't from the community may not understand, you know, that there are these distinctions made. And you deal with them in a very, you know, it was almost like just a matter of fact, you know, you list characteristics in a way that doesn't, you know, put us in a position to have to judge, but you know, you do kind of walk away with somewhat of a judgment. At least I did, but I'm highly judgmental.
Oh, sure.
So I'm sure that...
I wanted it to be laid out very clinically, so you had to look at the data and the evidence and go, oh... You know, even if at moments there was a certain gallows humor in it, you know. Oh.
So tell us, just for those who haven't read the book, and you should get the book. It's called Negroland, by the way. What are some of the characteristics of people who live in Negroland?
Well, you mean the desired physical.
The desired physical.
This is particularly important in, you know, something to be insisted upon most particularly if you are a girl. Growing up girl. And these are traits, exaggerations and intensifications of things that I think a lot of women of any group will recognize in terms of fashion magazines and, you know, hairstyles and pretty little noses and what. But if you were white, you know, you were still white, even if you didn't have the exact nose. You were taking it for granted in some way that this was your world. So, the backdrop of the appropriate look was you belong to a people who, many of whom are hopelessly beyond, you know, without this appropriate look, and at any moment you are working to strive to not to have that look. So, you know, and at any moment, something about your looks, your face, your body might slip back into that absolutely irrefutably undesirable territory. So it was all very specific. At best, you looked essentially like a wasp. But there were also, you know, there was a lot of room for the kind of Mediterranean or perhaps Mexican or Latin American, that kind of look. That meant you could have curly hair if it was lustrous, sort of like Jane Russell's hair. Is that is this a reference that many people still get? In fact, Jane Russell, that was a very good look. But you know, even nicer if you looked kind of like Grace Kelly. Now, you know, then whoa. And, you know, then your lips should not be, you know, the lips we now see that are so popular, the collagen.
Thank you, Chris.
Inflated lips. No. Those first came in, I think, with French movies because of Jean Moreau. But other, you know, a Negro with full lips, which were always called thick, out of the question. A broad nose. Of course, I am a respectable light brown, but I am light brown. Then there are many shades below. My sister was several shades browner, and we were both extremely aware. Though this was not something my parents in particular were obsessive about. Cannot not be aware. And again, geographical distinctions. My sister would swear that my parents' friends who'd come to Chicago from southern states like South Carolina or Virginia, they were the ones whom she was quite sure were a little nicer to me. I don't think she was necessarily wrong at all.
Did it shape your choices of mate? So your sister dated a white man.
That was one little narrative.
Okay, one little thing.
My sister mostly dated black men, married a black man, divorced him, and then as a young divorcee in New York, began to date from a wide range.
What you do when you're in New York.
By which time, yes, also we'd hit the 70s.
Love, yeah. We get it. But the question I'm asking is, did it shape, were there conversations in your home about, you know, when you bring a gentleman home, he's too dark, or his lips are too thick, or, you know, he doesn't come from the right family.
There were always comments in my home. There were always assessments being made in my home, in other homes. This is partly, it seems to me, this is bourgeois life. You know, a bourgeoisie, call it a middle class, an upper middle class, an upper class, in some way, it is always policing. Policing itself, policing its boundaries and borders. However, those doctrines are passed on, they might be done very tastefully and subtly, or they might be quite bold. But that is the definition of hierarchical privilege and of class privilege. So those were the forms it took. Everything from who are his parents to, well, he's not very attractive, meaning, right.
Wow.
Right. But, you know, he's doing very well, you know, he's doing well in school.
He's in medical school. So were there things that could get you into Negroland if you didn't possess the actual physical attributes that required?
Well, men always had it easier if they were achieving. You know, you could be very brown and you could acquire, this is the male story, a much lighter wife. And attributes, accomplishment, education. A certain amount of money, good manners.
You describe Sammy Davis Jr., who clearly...
Oh, when I'm watching him on TV.
Right.
Maybe. Yeah.
And the commentary, so there's always commentary when there are black people on television, right?
Oh,
when
it used
home.
To be, oh my God, everyone would, you know, hover around the
And it was not
the
about
TV
their
set.
Talent. It was always about hair, diction.
Well, it was also
noses.
About how they carried themselves. Were they being suitably dignified, or at least, you know, displaying their talent in a way that was not clownish or
embarrassing.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But also, you know, there weren't that many blacks in the 50s on TV. So it was also a mark of where are we going in the larger world? How are we being viewed? We got to see ourselves on the largest stage of American culture.
Who was an embarrassment back then to Negroland?
Well, certainly people like the old-time movie people, like Step and Fetch It or Man 10 Moreland. Hattie McDaniel, tricky. You could laugh, but it was very, very tricky. Davis Jr. was sometimes an embarrassment because when he got in, you know, when he was playing around with Dean and Frank Sinatra and the boys, he could get very ingratiating. You know, they pick him up, they tell strange little race jokes, and it was all, you know, full of camaraderie, but he was more often the butt of the jokes, and he needed them. He needed them so much, and he always laughed harder than everybody else, you know, Frank and Dean. No.
As I'm reading Negroland, I'm thinking about Rosewood, Florida, and Greenwood, Tulsa, Oklahoma. Places that would absolutely pass muster with Negroland. But despite all of the wealth and the success in those places, and there were dozens of them throughout the country, towns, whole towns, completely full of folk that you write about in this book, they did not escape the horrors of racism.
No, and those towns made them targets in a way because the towns were so visible, you know, and so easy to attack. And so easy to get angry at.
So how do you reconcile that? You know, as we fast forward today, we saw last week James Blake, tennis player, Harvard grad, well-spoken, great family. I think his mom is white, you know. Mm-hmm. He's definitely part of Negroland, waiting in front of a wealthy hotel, minding his business, and he ends up on the concrete, face down with a knee in his back and handcuffs. And we go back a couple of years to Beergate with Skip Gates. Skip Gates, professor, right? Definitely part of Negroland. I think he's married to a white woman, right? Trying to get into his own home, and he's arrested, and that becomes the thing where the president has to have beer with the police officer. So clearly...
Oh, manly bon ami. Yes, bon ami.
So clearly with all of this insulation and all of the upward mobility and the aspirations to be accepted, at the end of the day, you're just Negroes, still.
Unless you are in a protected space, you are. That's absolutely
And even
right.
in a protected space, they can firebomb you.
It can happen.
Right.
It's not as likely to happen, you know, to James Blake as to Trayvon Martin, but it can happen, yes. And in an ironic and terrible way, you know, politically, that's not so different from what I was saying a few minutes ago about, appearance. At any moment, something about your appearance could signal to someone who didn't like black people. You know, no, get them away. And this person looks like this means, so, you know, it's very much the same thing in a political and social and economic frame.
So is the
goal, and it happens to women too, and girls, not just guys.
No doubt. But is the goal of Negroland to denegrify the Negro? To un-Negro the Negro? You know, as I'm reading, you know, there's conversations again about blacks owning slaves and the way in which, you know, the relationship was. And then you talk about having for a better word, a maid, but you called her,
cleaning lady, okay.
Right. How often did
Meaning
she come?
Meaning she did, right. She came twice a week.
Okay, yeah. She came in through the front door?
Yeah, actually okay. She did, yeah.
Okay, these are important distinctions.
No, they are, absolutely.
Because the navigation of that space for people who, you know, who domestic work has been part of, you know, the only thing blacks could do in certain points in our history, to now have a domestic worker in your home.
Yes.
And to not treat that domestic, and there's a chasm economically.
Absolutely, and culturally, there are
right.
big distinctions. Yeah, absolutely.
How do you navigate that space?
How do I navigate it as
How
I
did you do it as a young girl,
right.
and then
well,
and now as an adult?
My mother and father instructed us, more my mother because my father was at the office, but they instructed us basically in the navigation. There are certain rules. We, Denise and I, as children,
your sister,
were not, yes, we had to make up our own beds. We were not allowed. Mrs. Blake was not allowed to make up our beds.
So one would
so
ask,
she could,
what's the point?
She could. I know.
I gotta make
She's
my bed.
Still in the house doing the housework. I know. She's still eating her lunch in the kitchen. In my mother's mind, it was partly an acknowledgement that she had had grandparents. Who had been in service in St. Louis to white families. But, you know, she said to me once, I loved those women dearly. So she, you know, a certain kind of, certain degree of politeness to her was a way of not betraying them. You know, it's a small thing. It's better than nothing. But I wanted to, by exposing, documenting, analyzing the contradictions and the discomforts, but also the satisfactions and pleasures. I'm not a heroine. There,
right.
I do some terribly snobbish things in
yes,
this
do.
Book. Yes,
you
I do.
You have to read it for yourself.
Yeah.
I'm not here to expose you.
I wanted to explore and expose and look at all of the. I wanted to really look at all the intricacies of privilege, especially privilege that is, it's asserting itself, and I mean Negroland privilege, and yet it's provisional, you know, and that also seems to me a very American, you know,
yes.
even though I'm speaking about a very particular background, it seems to me a very American set of negotiations.
That was what was actually refreshing.
Contradictions, always.
Always.
Yeah.
We live in a culture right now where race is unfortunately at the forefront of a lot of our conversations.
Class is huge.
Class is probably more important to have a conversation about than race. Race, I think, is a red herring. And what you've done with Negroland.
Sometimes it is, yeah.
Most of the time, it is a red herring that is used to keep people divided for the economic
All
purposes,
right.
of, you know.
Oh,
so
you're going into
yeah, I went a little
kind
of deep
Marxist
on y'all.
Analysis
I apologize
here. Okay.
Ahead
right.
of time, but you know, as I'm getting into Negroland, what strikes me is that it is, if you took away the race, it is just how people with money behave most of the time, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's really about money, privilege. We talk about white privilege, but privilege is privilege,
and
right?
And even when there's not that much money involved, it is about, you know, all the accoutrements of privilege, you know, you have good manners, you know, maybe you come from a distinguished old family that's fallen on hard times, you know, there's always some way to define it, to claim it, to insist on it, to display it, and all that, you know, that is all fascinating to me, and how that lives on inside you as your circumstances change, and how you struggle with it, or what parts of it, you know, you kind of are content to live with. I wanted that series of dramas to be
played out, and they play out beautifully. As a person that ran away from Negroland, myself, I escaped. So if you, don't tell on me. Don't tell. But I as a person that ran away, what struck me is that you know you build this kind of segregated fortress, right? Mm-hmm. That you hope insulates you from the larger mainstream society, and you still build. It's like everybody desires to be better than somebody. And that seems to be the quest, you know, whether it's the American quest. I don't know how other countries do it, but I'm sure that that's the goal, to get to the top of the food chain by any means necessary.
Up the food chain, yes. And to make clear that you have the possessions, internal and external, necessary to get that recognition, that the perks, the respect. And, you know, for us, there is this vast spectrum. You want perks, you want it to be treated nicely in a restaurant, you know, you want the saleswoman, if she's white or black, to be suitably deferential. That's not deeply attractive, but there you are. But then, you know, you keep going along the continuum. You know, you want to be treated like a first-class citizen. You know, you want just and honorable things as well. You want not to be closed out of a university because you're black. You know, if you're a responsible political person, and there were those in Negroland, then you know you want better things, more social justice for blacks as a whole. So you know it runs from large and worthy things to petty and snobbish things. Yeah.
And I want to talk about that in a second as it relates to W.E.B. Du Bois, which you eloquently talk about. But that's why I think race is irrelevant, because in this book you talk about so many people who literally walked away from being black.
Oh, and, you mean the ones who passed?
Passing, right? And your uncle walked away from being black and then came back.
Yeah, my great uncle.
Your great uncle. Yeah. Talk about your uncle that uncle walked Lucius. Away from blackness.
Well,
great uncle Lucius.
Great uncle Lucius, that's right. Great uncle Lucius, I really knew very little about him until I was, in fact, I knew nothing about him until I was in, I think, fifth grade. And my parents, at that point, I was at a mostly white school, and there were a little cluster of blacks there. But I was already, you know, having a little trouble negotiating, because one of my classmates, whom I'd assumed from her appearance was white, I suddenly realized was black when she and her parents showed up at the same events that my parents went to, and I knew their world of close friends was all black. And so, you know, I was working this through. My parents suddenly announced that our great uncle on my father's side was coming over to dinner, and then they had to tell us that he had been living as, passing as, a white man all these years. Well, why was he coming back? Now, I don't know that the story all emerged at the same time, because we were very polite. You wouldn't ask too many questions. All right, Uncle Lucius is coming to dinner. Hi, Uncle Lucius. Very nice to meet you. It turned out Uncle Lucius had retired from his job. So I kind of love this.
Again.
He retired from being a white man, so he had moved back.
He was like, whoo, that was a lot of work.
He had two jobs. I need a rest.
Right.
I need a rest. Oh, dear. So he moved back into a black neighborhood. Now, over the years, periodically, Uncle Lucius had seen my father, and the negotiation was always my cousin, their cousin Lillian, who was very fair. Uncle Lucius would get in touch with her, then they'd probably meet at a white restaurant, then she would call the darker members of the family, no doubt including his sister, and say, my great aunt, and say, someone would like to come visit you, or, you know, Lucius is in town, will you be at your office later, or we'll come by the house. So Uncle Lucius came back, we had dinner with him. I really don't remember much else. I think we saw him a few more times. Then a few years later, my father said, Uncle Lucius has gotten so difficult. He's always calling and accusing all of his black relatives, his Negro relatives, Daddy would have said, of neglecting him, which, you know, if you know anything about psychoanalysis, is kind of sublime, right? Oh, who's neglecting? No, who? So I don't really, you know, I didn't do this in the book, but the fact is, I don't really know when Uncle Lucius died or any such thing. There are a few pictures of him, but I don't remember much. What I do remember, which I think you want me to get to, is the premise of passing, which was accepted by these older generations. The premise was, you are doing this because you are going to find more opportunities. You know, you're in many practical ways, you will have a better life. So whether you are my uncle, my cousin, or my twin brother, and yes, there could be that too, I'm not going to tell. You know, we're going to navigate this, and I'm proud of you in some way, actually. I have mixed feelings, but there is a pride. You pulled it off, you succeeded, and you know, it's always a way of showing, oh, white, you know, is whiteness. It's pretty ridiculous, isn't it, you know? But my parents were actually a little disdainful of Uncle Lucius. Why? And here's where class comes in. In essence, they said, well, if you're going to bother to pass, Uncle Lucius had been a traveling salesman. You certainly need to be doing better than being a traveling salesman. You know, again, they didn't have
Why
to say
waste
it,
the
but,
white skin?
You know, right. I'm a doctor. My brothers are judges. You know, traveling salesman in the family? Who's been living as a white man? What a waste of your time, Uncle Lucius. So, you know, all of this is always going on. There was another cousin who'd risen higher in the world. So there was.
Do we know them? Are they famous?
His name was, I just use initials in the book.
Yes, you do.
Yeah. They called him John. John Eddie had been his southern name. I am sure when he moved into business in the north, he became John Edward. No doubt.
And that's what, you know, I think ultimately when I walked away and I was trying to understand, like, what is it that you want to leave us with? I mean, I was left with this notion that I said that, you know, it's really just about wanting to be better than and wanting to have the most that you can get out of this American dream by any means necessary. And if it means, you know, sectioning yourselves off and creating a whole subculture within a culture that puts you at the top of the food chain, so be it. And I wanted to know, is that the message that you wanted to leave us with?
Well, that's one, you know, that's okay. Part of really the examining of the structures of, I hope, race, class, gender. But I also wanted to look at how an individual, how a particular life, it's mine, but, you know, any reader is bringing that particular life. You know, here it is on this, you know, elaborate cultural, social, political map. How is one shaped? How are you made? How much freedom do you have to make yourself, to leave some of it behind, you know, or not? I wanted that, what is it like to engage with all of this? You know, and yes, you're solitary, you're on your own, but the world is constantly making you, your family, your larger group, your race, or your ethnicity, your class, your gender. How are you being made and unmade and remade, and what is the cost? Mm. Now, everybody has their own cost, but that was key, yeah.
And the responsibility. W.E.B. Du Bois talks about the talented tenth in the way that it's the responsibility of the talented tenth
Every race, he says, you know, has its, in essence, its superior class. You know, no race is without its first-rate leaders, who basically, they're the ones, the group, the race, stakes it, or the nation, stakes its reputation on. And, you know, we too, we blacks too, he's writing this at the start of the 20th century, we, you know, have our talented tenth, you know, and they are supposed to both exemplify intellectual, social accomplishment, moral, because he was a Victorian, and they are supposed to, by example, but also through action, lead the race forward. Many years later, he delivered a speech to a posh black fraternity, which was a severe critique of this. He said, you know, I didn't fully realize, though I wondered, how easily, you know, these these accomplishments, this privilege, this status that I'm talking about could turn inward, become narcissistic, and basically, you know, become a question of self-congratulation and self-satisfied advancement only for one's own.
So did the talented 10th drop the ball?
Some of them did. Not all of them. You know, Julian Bond died recently.
I could do good examples,
but, you know, as a class, there's much to be criticized. And, you know, yet, as I say, there are things in that world that I love dearly and that it gave me, and I can't lie about that and be virtuous at the cost of honesty. But yes, in crucial ways, they dropped the ball or turned away from the ball to pursue their own lives.
You write that I'm obsessed with James Weldon Johnson's 1933 diagnosis of this condition, and the condition that you write about, I want you to talk about, and it deserves repeating. Awaiting each colored child are cramping limitations and buttressed obstacles in addition to those that must be met by youth in general. How judicious he is, you write. Talk to us about the impact of this James Weldon Johnson's writing.
Well, I found that as an adult, of course, but it resonated with me because the passage goes on to talk about how the parents, and again, this is something that spreads out to, you know, any family in which older generations have had great historic, you know, great suffering, a real burden of historical oppression, suffering, whatever. How does this pass itself on to the child? And what? And often it's unconscious, but every parent, James Weldon Johnson says, has to think about how much you spare the Negro child, the full knowledge of the burdens of discrimination, oppression, hatred, and how much you prepare them. And he said either course, you know, chosen badly, can lead to, and he uses the phrase, spiritual disaster for the child. And, you know, and I you know, there are there are so many of us, and I don't only mean blacks, though that's what I'm writing about in this book, you know, with these historical legacies,
burdens
that
even.
We and burdens that our parents have perhaps imposed too much on us. You know, the parent who talks and no, you're that, believe me, this is what these people will do, that, no. Or, you know, I had a friend, the child of Holocaust survivors, whose mother used to lock herself in the bathroom and threatened to kill herself regularly. You know, what do you do with these things? What do you make of them? And what do they make of you? But the other thing is, you know, how do the parents? The parents have had to, they've inherited that from their parents. So they are negotiating constantly with these legacies and with the possibility, as they see you navigating, of spiritual disaster for themselves too. So it's very complicated and kind of heartbreaking. I mean, I'm thinking less about myself at that moment than about my parents. Well,
there was a recent study, actually, of Holocaust survivors that showed that trauma actually is passed down genetically.
Absolutely.
And, you know, when I was reading that, I was thinking about that, you know, the trauma that is passed down. And that was during just a, you know, and I say just, but it was a short period of time when you think about, you know, hundreds of years from the Native. Time,
she
in terms of years, like 10 years
period.
Versus, you know, and it's not a comparison. Okay.
Yes, of course.
The larger point is that historically, you know, whatever trauma happens to a group of people, it does get passed down, whether you speak it to your children or not. It's in their DNA.
Exactly.
So it's a responsibility for the parent to prepare that child for what's going on inside themselves that they probably can't
and
even express.
And if the parent, even if the parent has been relatively sheltered, if they know the history of their people, you know, then that's there. Also, where is the child growing up? You know, where, how are the threats constituting themselves even in that? You know, as long as your status, your protections are not secure, you know, that that burden, that trauma. I am amazed that that hasn't. I think more psychoanalysts maybe have been working on that than we think. But I was, amazed that that hasn't been talked about much more in terms of, you know, the history of oppressed groups.
Well, you've covered an awful lot, and I could literally talk to you all evening. I've spent like a lot of time with you, and mm-hmm. it's been a pleasure. But I want to make sure that we get people who have questions involved in asking Margo Jefferson.
Okay, and we have about 20 minutes.
I don't know. Yeah. I'm not the timekeeper. My watch works.
We should know. Yeah.
Okay. And who's facilitating? I'm gonna just give up my mic. Okay. All right. Okay, yeah, absolutely. The man in the wonderful red shirt.
I wouldn't have worn it had I remembered I was going to be here tonight.
Okay, it's beautiful.
No,
there
it
is. How much connection is there between Negroland and non-Negroland in dealing with something like the James Blake situation last week? And I'm wondering if a child of Negroland is less able to comprehend that then say, and I'll never pronounce his name right, Ta-Nehisi Coates, his son would be able to deal with that and understand that.
It, you know, again, it's a good question to ask coming out of, you know, the James Weldon Johnson quote and what we were just talking about, this complex balance of protection and preparation, warning. James Blake, I can't address. You know, interestingly to me, the newspapers were identifying him as biracial, which he is, but that's quite recent that they use that identification. He's been described as black before, African American, so that's a small thing. I don't know what he was taught or not, but once you also become a celebrity, you know, you are living in a very sheltered world. So hard to say. Very, very hard to say. It's going to be more of a shock the more protections you've had. For, you know, it's the more shocking it's going to be because some part of you, whatever you're being taught, you know, in school by your parents, some part of you, there's the child in you that's always been protected. And some part of you is going to think, surely this will not stop. And that is not a criticism of James Blake. That's just, what? Yeah, I mean, I know I'd still have that reaction. Some part of me would be saying, look, you know, look at me, look at how, what? But you listen to how I'm talking, what?
But it was calm, though. Mm-hmm. And I think if James Blake was not from Negroland, it would have ended a lot more horrifically. I think his, like, incredulous, you know, like, am I actually on the ground being handcuffed? You know, whereas if it was somebody that experienced this on a regular basis or might have ended up, because this guy came out of nowhere. He didn't identify himself, didn't ask a question. So it might have ended in a fight that would have probably ended in a death or, God forbid, something of that nature.
Yeah. And he has made...
So Negroland protected him.
It did.
Because he couldn't believe, it took him that long to figure out I'm on the ground.
Also, he was easily the protections of... In addition to, you know, oh, look at how I'm talking, and look,
right.
his fame protected him too. You know, he did, and good for him. He had his, after a few minutes, it protected him.
Right.
And he said that himself to his credit. He could make the phone call. Some officer, someone said, oh, wait a minute, it's a tennis star, you know, to the policeman. And he has been very good about making clear, yeah, it's good that it happened to me because it's calling attention to people who don't have my resources.
Absolutely.
When it happens to them.
Absolutely. Okay. Wonderful lady. We're going to bring a mic to you so that it can be like loud.
Okay. To the gentleman in the bright red shirt, yes. I really like your question, but I will say that Ta-Nehisi has said that his son's experience of being African American in America is a lot more mild than Ta-Nehisi's was because he is protected by class, mm-hmm. by education,
right.
by
yes.
access.
Yes, that's a good
so
point.
So in the same question, Ms. Jefferson.
Yes.
How has your experience in Negroland differed from that of your parents? In what ways are you more innocent and protected?
Oh,
and in what ways are you
question.
More...
Very good question.
...wily, more experienced
yes.
and knowing?
All right. My parents put me in a progressive, very good, largely but not wholly white school when I was in kindergarten. In a certain way, again, it was within its limitations progressive. You know, they didn't suddenly send me to the equivalent of the military academy. There was a space in that school, and, you know, there was a space in that school where 4- and 5-year-olds were making friends. You know, there were moments, there were, you know, my book is partly about those disconnects and dissonances, but there was some space for something that I would call taking each other for granted as personalities. We all knew we were very smart. We all knew we were being cosseted and treated well because of that, and trained, and in that way, pampered. So, you know, that was a certain ground of privilege we shared. But naturalness is what I would say when you can start very early in as generous an environment as society will permit at that point. That already, and that was something my parents chose, gave me a comfort level, which is a form of wiliness, you know, to move into the world with. You know, they made sure that we, you know, got all the cultural pleasures and rewards and duties. You know, every child doesn't want to take ballet lessons or, you know, whatever. But they wanted us, all of this, to feel, you know, like part of our world and like our legacy, our lineage. They had to balance it with making sure we got enough black history. We're going to see the Catherine Dunham troupe and, you know, the Royal Ballet. But, and they also, they had their own, you know, they were much more suspicious of white individual people, with good reason. Their history had been different. But they also, my parents, there were things that they just loved. My mother read to me all the time, and all about books and love literature. My father had been a jazz musician and a classical musician in college and grad school. You know, so these, you know, jazz was my legacy. Going to the symphony was my legacy too. Of course, I'm simplifying it or prettifying it a bit, but that's, they made sure we had all those things. They had both grown up with less money and less access. Their parents were both very ambitious, but, you know, and both my grandmothers had gone to a little black school in the South, but, you know, everything was much more difficult. And they, you know, they sheltered us and prepared us in the best way. I'll tell you a funny, it's a gender story, from my father. This shows you the meticulousness. He said at one point to my mother, she told me this years later, you know, it's important that we make sure and take the girls out regularly to very nice restaurants, because when they are old enough to have boyfriends and suitors, I don't want them being so naive that they're blown off their feet, you know, when some feckless, not particularly worthwhile man takes them to a nice restaurant. Oh, you know. So every little detail was being tended to, and that you take what you take for granted makes you wily, doesn't it? Even as it can also make you naive and somewhat spoiled. And I was not exempt from both those things, but also the insistence that we achieve, and, you know, did help somewhat. You know, did stop us from being total brats, I think.
The beautiful lady in the shirt with her hand up.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Two beautiful ladies up there. Thank you so much for coming and speaking with us. I'm finding this fascinating. I would like to know, given the title of your book, why your audience is lacking in major numbers of African Americans.
Well, my audience tonight, I don't know.
This is Roosevelt House. This is the basic demographic of the Roosevelt. Isn't this normal? It's pretty normal. Been here a couple of times. This is who shows up.
This is Upper East Side?
You know, I think it depends. I think it...
This is what we're going to get.
Yeah, I mean, I think it depends on where one appears.
Okay, do you, perhaps think that...
I've been getting... See, now I'm starting to sound a little defensive. I've been getting a lot of emails and responses and whatever is from all manner of black and people of color. But, you know, yeah, I think this is probably the Roosevelt House constituency. And, you know, I want the book to connect to people other than my group of black people.
And isn't it on a bestsellers list? Didn't we just find that?
It's number 20, okay. Which is on the extended
list. That's good. That's good. Skid this handsome man right here with the glasses. Yes.
First of all, I'm a marketing consultant, and I want to congratulate you on a great book cover.
Oh. Yeah.
I think it's fabulous.
Thank you. I like it a lot, too.
Question about income inequality. We all know it's the buzzword. They're probably talking about it right now on CNN. What has happened to Negroland as a percentage of the population from 20 years ago to where we are today, and what do you think it will be like 20 years from now?
Well, we could be heading economically in this country, economically and politically, for just major complications. 20 years, I can't say. What has happened, Negroland has integrated a great deal, and that really started in the late 60s, when suddenly job opportunities and training programs opened up for particularly, you know, blacks, privileged blacks. There could be, you know, a citizen of Negroland who is, you know, the head of American Express or blah, blah, blah. You know, it's really expanded its reach in terms of being a portion, a population, a world within what one might call white land.
With Jay-Z and Beyonce?
Though there are, Jay-Z and Beyonce are what used to be called kind of cafe society.
Oh, okay.
You know, show business people.
Right, okay,
yeah.
Okay. Michelle Obama before the White House?
No. Wait, I take that back. Michelle Obama, when she was growing up in what was a very solid, you know, working class, lower middle class family, no, but, you know, the world being what it is, we know perfectly well that once Michelle and her brother got to Princeton, you know, things, and once she got very good jobs in Chicago, then access.
They got grafted in.
Access was granted even, yeah.
Any questions? We'll wait for the microphone. Wonderful person here, yes.
Hello, I'm curious, and I haven't read the book yet, so maybe you covered this already. How much explicit preparation did your family give for interacting with white folks, or was there an assumption because you were from Negroland that you would be treated better?
When you say interacting with, we were given, I see what you mean. I was thinking at first, do you mean the ones I was going, say, to school with, or the larger, more hostile world of white people? But
either or.
We were given, particularly as we got older each year, and particularly when as adolescents approached, we were given, you know, talks, warnings. Some of them took the form of, you know, white people will always think, therefore you must behave well. You know, the piano teacher who enters about five of us into some national piano teachers contest, you know, you must all play very well because these teachers expect nothing of you. You know, we're getting that. You're also overhearing these talks, you know. So it's a combination of all the things you are taught and the urgency of them, and then those turn into specific warnings. And then as adolescence comes, you know, everyone is worried about interracial and sometimes, you know, intra-religious dating, you know, and I think all the parents of everyone at my school, but certainly not least the black parents, were sending out intense warnings. Be careful, keep your distance, you know.
So did you feel adequately prepared?
For my life?
No, I mean, well, my parents tried to raise me as a raceless human being in a white neighborhood.
I'm sorry, your parents what?
Tried to raise me as a raceless human being in a white neighborhood, and it didn't work out so well. So I guess I'm just...
Raceless.
You know?
Yeah, that's well, you're much younger. Yeah.
Yeah. So for me, I felt completely unprepared because I thought I was a person, and then I got to school, and kids were calling me the N-word, and I had to go home and ask my dad what it meant. So I've always just been curious about people that grow up in Negroland and how they're prepared, or they have moments like that where they're shocked by how they're treated.
Yes, both things. You are constantly being prepared, but some of it is not spoken. It's just the intensity, you know, of your manners and the demands placed on you. This book is partly a record of many little shocks. They're not all huge, but to a child, they are. Not the inward, subtler things, you know, again, because of the particular protections. But yeah, there are always a series of shocks. Yes.
Great question.
And then how much do you tell your parents, or when do you decide to hide that yourself and grapple? Yeah.
Any other questions? And just piggybacking on that, you were raised two sisters.
Two of us, yeah.
Was the script different? Would it have been different? Would you know what the script would be if you had a brother?
They'd be more frightened for him, and also they'd be more frightened for him in the white world, and they'd be more frightened that he might be tempted, you know, by an unsuccessful Jay-Z, you know, by the glamour. This is how they would have put it, by the glamour of the ghetto, and that he would sort of start going
the way you wanted to play double dutch down the street.
In a tiny, tiny way. But, you know, boys had more license. So they'd be afraid both of his possible actions and of perceptions. Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes. Okay, we'll get to you. Yep, we're going to get a mic over to you. Hold on. Yes, this wonderful person right here. Yes.
I hope this is okay to ask, because I want to ask you something personal about the voice intonation of Negroland. You've all heard me speak for 2 seconds. I'm an English professor, and when I speak, I sound like a person from Queens. I do not have an upper class accent. And your accent, like we're both like professors, I have an accent that marks me as not an upper class person, like a out of borough person. Mm-hmm. And you have a patrician accent. It's almost like not spoken now. So what happened to the language of your grandparents who spoke Southern, or your parents probably did not have this patrician accent, and your accent is so upper class patrician, it almost sounds like a contemporary Eleanor Roosevelt to me.
No, it's an interesting question. And you wanted to, and I will get to it. You wanted to say something?
I can see you've got your hand up. I was struck by the differences in your speech in the two of you. You
That's
say
right.
that you are.
I'm on purpose.
That you are. I know that I gathered, and I wondered why.
So that Negro
because. As a as a person who grew up in Negroland, I would never have been allowed to talk like
exactly.
that or play with people whose grammar was bad.
Well, right. neither
Not
was
that
I.
Your grammar
no, no, no,
was
no, no, no. No, my grammar's bad all the time on purpose.
Yes. But she,
I was raised just, and I rebelled, and I've been rebelling my entire life. So it's just I reject
I
all
the
of
same
that.
Voice.
So
yes,
that's
exactly.
you know.
Exactly.
So
now
it's more fun.
And I heard that exactly. That perfect.
Having more fun.
You know. This was something that we all grappled with, because of course we wanted to also have black voices. My friends and I wanted to have black voices too, so we would practice them. They didn't go over terribly well with my parents, but Chicago did have a range. My mother spoke a lot like I do, though I had a little career in the theater, so that may have... but she had a wonderful ear. She could bring a kind of genteel southernness into it. My father had a slight, just easy southern accent. Chicago is full of people who immigrated from all manner of places. So you get, you get a lot. I would say my parents, having grown up much more in black worlds, were much better at moving between black vernacular and standardized English than either my sister or I. It's the way we were brought up. So-called standardized English was what we spoke, and it wasn't surprising to me.
Okay, I'm getting a rap sign because I think you want to see the debate. You want to see the okay. Let's take that
okay,
one.
Can we take
we'll
one
take,
more?
We'll take two more.
Okay.
And beautiful woman in the back. Yes.
Good evening. You mentioned in the beginning that you grew up in terms of class and the structure in class, middle class, upper class, lower class. Are you surprised that today we still live in that manner, especially with a lot of gentrification that's going on now?
No. America is so riddled with, and it's not just America, my God, but you know, it has always been, hierarchical, class-based, though it's always pretending not to be. I mean, America is so strange. You can become Donald Trump, but
why?
The need to move, the need to move up, to prove yourself, to dominate, whether it's money or other kinds of power. No, that's what this country is. So, I'm not surprised at all. And there isn't any group, some of whose members haven't grasped for that and found it and don't use it.
Well, this, and I know a lot of you have questions, but the beauty of this event is that Ms. Margo Jefferson will be signing books, and you get to talk to her one-on-one, and she's not going anywhere. So I just want to thank each and every one of you for your wonderful questions and your presence. I want to thank you, Margo Jefferson,
thank
for
you
this book.
Much.
Have a good evening.